the pleasure to invite Thanai, Professor Thanai Zitkuya, who is by profession a scientist, engineer, and also active in many NGOs related to the promotion of renewable energy in Turkey and beyond. And Thanai, you're also one of our board members, and I have the pleasure now to invite you to speak and share with us the developments in Turkey. Thanai, can we?
Thank you very much, Stefan.
There you are,
very good. I will share my presentation, just a second. Okay. So thank you very much, Stefan, in organizing this webinar to let people know what's happening globally in wind energy development. Regarding
presentation,
this,
can I just click on presentation?
Can you?
Mode,
can you
we can see, but it's not full screen mode now.
Okay, sorry. That's what you want. That's it. Is it clear now? Yes.
Not yet. Yeah, now it's good. Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Now, as globally, everybody, we are also affected by the new situation. Now we are in our houses, trying to do everything online. So this is the new condition. We need to adapt ourselves all together. But wind turbines are producing, continuing to produce. And Turkey also, we have many developments regarding all renewable energy. Now it's clear for everybody that to get rid of the problems, to get to make climate change mitigation, and also stopping any possible surprises like COVID-19, we need to stop burning fossil fuels in this atmosphere. Now, International Renewable Energy Agency in April declared that we need to do something about transition to 100% renewable energy if we want to really handle or not again face such difficulties. 7 million people die each year from air pollution, and the people who die are okay, but the others who get the sickness due to air pollution, they need to get some medicine, and 5 or 10 years later they die again. But when you don't have medicine for something, 1 million people die in 6 months. So we as environmental platform of Turkey and also Eurosolar manage to disseminate this information in the country. It was unfortunately an argument for more being dependent on renewable energy. So now I will just try to make a very brief summary statistic report for development of wind energy in Turkey. So that's I'm one of the founders of Turkish Wind Energy Association, and Turkish Wind Energy Association is doing a good work in Turkey, and these statistics are every 6 months are published. So this is the last one published in July 2020. As you see, the cumulative installations for wind power plants in Turkey has a regular constant increase, even though we have many difficulties for the investors regarding the regulations and the existence of the natural gas take or pay agreements since years, forcing energy efficiency to, and renewable energy implementation to be delayed because these long-term agreements are made so that even if you buy, if you don't buy the natural gas, you need to pay for it. So that's why this is a problem. But as renewable energy started to get cheaper, production of wind energy and solar energy, now natural gas power plants are in trouble in Turkey. They cannot pay their credits, so they are planning how to make a slow bankruptcy. So that this is the case. Some of them are moving to other countries, and renewable energy with this cheapest thing. We have the resource, we have the businessman who wants to invest in it. And we have some people also in the public bodies trying to support and open the obstacles, remove the obstacles in wind energy development. Of course, the auctions are becoming a common thing, but it's like national lottery tickets. Everybody thinks they will get it, but at one point, one or two company gets it, and the others are disappointed. This happened in Turkey. We have 1 gigawatt auctions for wind and photovoltaics. And the other companies who didn't want the auction, they started to ask, find a solution. Now mini yakas, mini auctions are in the agenda. We shall see what will happen. It's also delayed because of the COVID thing. Anyway, so, but under all those conditions, we have still have this constant increase of wind power plants. So now we have about 8,288 megawatt, about 8 gigawatt of wind. When we look at annual installations for wind power plants in Turkey, in 2010 it was 500 megawatt. The highest one was 2016, about 1.3 gigawatt. Then after we see a decrease. Now 2020, so far in 6 months, we had only 232 megawatt. When we look at the electricity generation of wind power plants in Turkey in 2020, January, it was 2 million megawatt hours. And so in February, it reduced a little bit, but these are the seasonal changes. In January, it was about 9% of all electricity supplied from wind energy in Turkey. And in June, it is 5.63. The average is about 8.52. So 8.52% of all electricity in our country is produced from wind energy. And when we look at the investors, operational wind power plants already operating, mainly we have a few companies about more than 500 megawatt, and the others are following with difficulties. And the smallest, I mean, starts from Zorlu Enerji. Many of them are local companies, as you see, and these are the percentages of how much of the wind power plants they own. And when we look at the companies who are the wind power plant turbine manufacturers, Nordex is leading in Turkey, Enercon is following, and Vestas, then Siemens Gamesa, and General Electric. And Siemens Gamesa, Siemens is the winner of this auction. So they are preparing this 1 gigawatt wind turbine and producing locally in Turkey and supporting with a research center. And the others are not so effective in the market. And when we look at the regional wise, how is the situation? EGNC is leading now, followed by Marmara, then the Mediterranean and Central Anatolia. So that's the distribution according to the Turkish regions. And when you look at the cities, Izmir, the Western Anatolia agency is leading, followed by Balıkesir, Manisa. These are all Western Anatolia cities. Then we have Dardanelle, and then followed by East Mediterranean cities, Hatay. And even in Turkey, you see over here the cities leading with the highest potential. Then the other parts of Turkey also with a 35% to 40% capacity is also feasible for wind farm applications. That's the cities. Then when we look, let's look at the ones which are under construction. The under construction wind power plants in earlier years, every 6 months reports show that was less, and in 2015 we had 2 gigawatt capacity, followed by 1.8 gigawatt in 2016. But now we have in July 2020 2.45 gigawatt wind turbines, wind power plants are in under construction. And for these wind power plants who are under construction, these are the companies, and still it's an even distribution. These are part of the tenders, and the authority declared that they will allow companies and make a provide connection to the grid. So these are the winners of these tenders in different times. Okay, these are the investors distribution. And the wind power plants which are under construction, General Electric is leading, Nordex following, then Vestas and Siemens. And the new wind power plants will be are being constructed in Marmara region, mainly Marmara region, then followed by Ege region. And when we look at the cities well, for the new under construction, we see more Thrace region, Istanbul, and northwestern Anatolia. That's the second big potential. And then we have licensed wind power plants. According to investors, there is a huge, very, very, very small ones also. When we look at the, again, licensed wind power plants, it's around Marmara region. And now pre-licensed wind power plants, this includes the auctions. This is 1,000 megawatt one is included. This is the first one, will be finalized later. And 22% of this pre-licensed one is the result of the auction, 1,000 megawatt won by Siemens. And this is also Marmara region, around Istanbul and Dardanelle. Okay, now when we look at the cities, Thrace region, European part of Turkey, is more success. successful. Edirne also near Greece border. Then Istanbul, Çanakkale, and Western Anatolia. Presentation, a brief introduction of the statistics of Turkish wind power development. Thank you very much for listening.
Thanks so much, Tanay, for many, many figures here, and that is very impressive. I think that there's some interesting developments obviously going on. You also mentioned some issues with the auction system there. Now, let me just ask you for clarification. You mentioned that there's now some decrease in market volume. Is there an impact coming from auctions? Is the impact coming from the COVID-19 situation? How would you describe that? Tanay? Now you're frozen.
The only thing was this was unlicensed by the authority buying electricity from photovoltaic panels mainly, because it was 1 megawatt was the limit, so it didn't work for wind turbines. The community power, what we are defending, the ownership of the local people, smaller ones, let's say, didn't happen in Turkey. But with photovoltaics, since they are more modular, we have 7,000 megawatt. So 7,000 individual projects, individual people, I mean, normal people who have connection to the grid is a customer. Now we have 7,000 megawatt. It's real community power. Remember, I was mentioning that this unlicensed application will be the base for community power development. Yes, it happened this way. Now it's removed. Then people in photovoltaics I'm talking about, people needs to have a certain contract capacity, and if they have this contract, they can build photovoltaic panels, which I'm doing for my house, for example. But wind, it didn't work, so unlicensed applications were delayed a little bit or stopped even. It didn't affect wind energy development. But coming back to mini, not because of COVID-19, it was always delayed. If you remember, when we were working in Sarıgerme, also 1,000 companies applied for measurements. Then in the 10th month, it was delayed again. So this delaying procedure is dependent on some other factors. With COVID, I think it had positive effects also about why we need to use renewable energy. And also people learned if human activities are not destroying due to transportation, fossil fuel combustion, nature is happy, people are more healthy, and that's why it was a good show to human beings that how we should behave, why we should live in harmony with nature. So these are the positive things. For myself also, I was traveling, maybe you also traveling a lot, but now I can do everything. I can do everything from my office. I'm saying so I just refreshed myself, as you see, so I have a time to exercise, I have a time to sleep more. So I thought I retired, but I look as if I was just born, huh? Another maybe a few years I will continue. So I mean, I don't make any connections with COVID-19, and unfortunately nobody makes this connection. We should make a connection to get rid of COVID-19. We need to stop burning fossil fuels in this atmosphere, but now everybody is looking for a medicine and for what is this issue for not protecting people from the diseases. So if you find one medicine, the next week, if you don't stop the cause, we will face it again. So it must be the time to distribute this quality to everybody. And the destination is, of course, transition to 100% renewable energy.
That's absolutely what we need.
And, yes. And European Green Deal, which is very important. The European Commission decided to go in that direction. And also global transition by International Renewable Energy Agency is also showing this way. And Europe opened enough funds to support this European Green Deal. Any of our colleagues in Europe likes to cooperate with us and in a consortium. I mean, we are not planning to make any project proposals ourselves, but when you look at the European thing in with this time, I would like to ask friends to contact us, and we can be good partners to save Europe. Thank you very much.
Let's do that. Thank you. And I think indeed there's no doubt that this pandemic situation is kind of bringing us back to where we live and look more around where we are. Tanay, thanks a lot for your insight.